This video is brought to you by CuriosityStream, which now comes with a really cool thing called Nebula for free. One of the greatest things about PC gaming is all the options at your disposal. There are tons of brands for cases, power supplies, a million hard drives, motherboards. For gaming CPUs, there was virtually one option for a while, and then Ryzen became a thing, and well, look at that. Nvidia dominates on the GPU front, but AMD is improving there, and oh wow, would you look at that? And Intel is getting on that soon. Then there are lots of monitors, memories, and lots of options for operating systems. Oh no. So far, Microsoft has been pretty aware of their dangerous position as the sole option for an operating system, and they are, for example, publishing a lot of their own games on platforms outside the Microsoft Store, like Steam. Not to mention making it very easy to use their operating system for free on Eternal Trial mode with very little penalty. But given the history of what happens every time options are reduced to one, I'm always alarmed by the ever-growing dominance of Windows as a gaming OS. Not to mention how it tends to limit the options in terms of what a gaming PC can be. Imagine, for example, if Alienware's fancy-dandy handheld PC computer wanted to have its own custom OS optimized for lower resource usage or controller input. But they can't. They get the same Windows as everyone else. Apple seems even less interested on gaming outside their very specific walled garden, so that leaves us with the Penguin, the family of operating systems using the Linux kernel. Now, this is not the first time I even touch on the concept of Linux gaming. I did this video in 2018 using a low-end Nvidia GT1030 and was positively surprised of how well Steam could do. But in that video, I said the following about AMD. I will focus on Nvidia GPUs for this video, as the drivers are also the easiest to install. I am aware that there's a powerful open source AMD driver, but it is also a fair bit more complicated to install. More on that later. Well, this turns out was not true. What happens is that if you Google AMD driver Linux, you get support pages that are extraordinarily intimidating for any Linux noob, versus the one thing that Nvidia provides for installation. In reality, the current situation with AMD is way, way better. Open source AMD drivers are not only very mature, but included in the mainline Linux kernel, which is a fancy way of saying that for a lot of AMD GPUs, Linux will just work for gaming out of the box without any extra effort. Now, if you try building a budget gaming PC in 2020 from new components, AMD APUs dominate so thoroughly that there just aren't sub 100 options for dedicated GPUs anymore, and competitive Intel options are still off in the future. So that leads me to wondering, if you're building a low-end AMD APU gaming PC, like this fantastic mini PC that I built for a video earlier this year, that now never leaves my desk, how viable of a system is Linux as a gaming OS in case Microsoft starts to reconsider its position as a benevolent dictator? For this experiment, I will be using the aforementioned mini PC based around a Ryzen 3 3200G with Vega 8 integrated graphics and 8GB of RAM. Since my interest here is not to squeeze the best Linux performance ever, since that is beyond my current Linux skills, I wanted to see what sort of thing could be achieved with a lower effort to someone considering joining in. Linux, as I previously mentioned, is not one monolithic operating system but a family of open source systems which can all, given enough skill, be customized to work and look in widely different ways, including minimization of the background usage of resources. Ubuntu is one of the most popular Linux distributions due to its large community, ease of use, and it being impressively easy to install, at least on an empty hard drive. Lubuntu is a variant of Ubuntu designed to be as lightweight as possible by removing a lot of the non-essential services and using a very lightweight UI, which still looks pretty freaking good. I will say, if you're looking for an OS for a laptop that is too weak for Windows, this is right up there. They have improved a ton since the last time I tried. And more importantly, Ubuntu is fully supported by Steam, and installing it is very easy. And right from there, you have several games available to play. But before launching our first game, a clarification. AMD GPUs on Linux use two things, the main open source driver and Mesa that translates OpenGL or Vulkan to the driver. In Nvidia, the proprietary driver replaces all of that. In AMD, you can update Mesa very easily with a command or the package manager. But the base open source driver comes in the kernel, which is like the core of the operating system that interacts with the hardware. The good thing about this is that very often you do not have to worry about drivers as long as the OS is updated. The bad thing is that distributions of Ubuntu do not really use the latest kernel, but rather a few versions behind that have been thoroughly tested for bugs, meaning that it sometimes takes a bit of time for critical driver fixes to get to you. The good thing is that even for a Linux noob like myself, changing the kernel is super easy thanks to software like Uku. I changed from 5.3, which was the stock kernel included in Ubuntu when I installed it, to 5.4.15, which was the latest stable kernel at the time of writing. By the time this video comes out, there will likely be a newer kernel, but when I tested to verify, the performance was mostly the same. In fact, when I tested a bunch of games running the stock kernel or the latest kernel, I didn't see that much of a performance difference. So for most stuff, you might want to stick to a tested stock kernel if you experience bugs or devices not working. However, it can improve game compatibility, and there is one example where I noticed this: Shadow of the Tomb Raider. It will simply crash when trying to render anything on the stock kernel, and it just works on the newer kernel. Also, I made sure to get the CPU in performance mode with this command before testing, which actually made a difference. Okay, let's get to actual testing. Part 1, native ports. The situation with games being ported natively to Linux is tricky. Lots of indie games are still coming, eventually to Linux, but big players like Rocket League have recently been retracting their support, which is a bit of a shame and possibly marks the start of a trend of Unreal Engine moving away from Linux, which is worrying. Still, other Linux ports continue to exist, like the full modern Tomb Raider trilogy, ported to Linux by the great Feral Interactive. Since all three Tomb Raider games have included benchmarks, this is a great place to start doing some comparisons. Another thing I'm going to benchmark is Counterstrike Global Offensive. Valve has had a long-term commitment of porting and maintaining their games to Linux, concerned, as I am, of the consequences of Windows dominance. Now, there is a consistently present belief that I see in comments and discussions about Linux where people recommend it as a way of getting more performance out of low-end PCs, and I have issues with how often I see this advice. I see where this comes from. Distributions like Ubuntu have vastly lower background resource usage compared to Windows, but even native ports are done in such a way that often performance impact is inevitable, and people like Feral do their very best to try and get as close to Windows as possible. For example, Tomb Raider and Rise of the Tomb Raider both came remarkably close to Windows, much better than I expected. The difference is within a range that is surprisingly manageable. Shadow of the Tomb Raider is a different story, but given the issues I was having with the kernel, this is likely some bigger issue that requires a bit of tinkering, so I will give this one the benefit of the doubt. Counter-Strike Global Offensive, on the other hand, is another story. To my immense surprise, while running benchmarks, often Linux will come out on top by the tiniest margin, not enough for me to go, "Linux is better for low-end AMD CSGO gaming, download now!" After all, this is within margin of error, but the fact that at least it's perfectly on par is pretty amazing when you consider how much lighter Linux can be. However, as you probably already know, native is only the tip of the Linux iceberg when it comes to gaming, especially now. The constant start of this show is Proton, a compatibility layer mostly maintained by Valve and integrated right into Steam. In fact, I was surprised to notice that Valve is so confident in this tool that when searching for games in Linux, they will display games officially supported by Proton along with native ports without anything clearly telling you that they're running on a compatibility layer until you click play. And while this video was being edited, a new version of Proton came out. It did not change the performance of this test, but it does increase compatibility, increasing the list of games that you can play on Linux. For example, the ever-fantastic Dark Souls 3 is directly supported and works pretty well, with the additional advantage that since this is Steam that we're talking about, my dear Steam controller, rest in pieces, works out of the box with all my presets without any issues. When comparing to Windows, the performance impact was there, and it was definitely noticeable. A loss of more than 10 or 15 FPS at this level is nothing to joke about, but it's still playable and usable. Now you can break out of the Steam maintained list of Probe and Proton games and use Proton on pretty much anything in your Steam library, which can have mixed results. There's a fantastic community maintained site called ProtonDV, where people can make reports of their experiments and games are assigned a rating depending on how well they work in Proton. The original Subnautica has a gold rating, so it seemed like a no-brainer for a quick experiment. At 720p and the lowest settings, the proportional impact of the Proton penalty seems somewhat consistent with my previous experience. Still amazingly playable on this APU, even if the impact can occasionally be quite large. It is worth noting that while, from a beginner's point of view, Proton appears pretty much as a plug-and-play solution, there are still some quirks to the system that I wish I knew before. For example, most games running on DirectX need shaders to be compiled in the background, which can be pretty quick on a decent PC, but on anything more modest can take a significant amount of time. Since for most cases there's no visual indication that this is happening in the background, you might launch a game and wonder why is it stuttering so bad? As I did when trying Hollow Reach from the Master Chief Collection, which also had a pretty high ProtonDB rating. Turns out, I just had to leave the game running on its own to compile shaders in the background for 10 minutes, and then it worked fine. The same impact I saw from previous games was maintained. The game runs very well with a proportional performance impact, so while again I cannot quite go and recommend Linux as a low-end PC gaming solution, the compatibility layer does a remarkably good job on some games. Now, can a game theoretically perform better using Proton or Wine dxvk? Yes, there are specific examples that float around from time to time, such as advances the community have been making on a hidden time. But it is worth noting that most of the time when I have seen these experiments, they're running on much more powerful hardware, and I have not been able to reproduce them on a budget part just yet. In fact, I wanted to include a hidden time in my test for this video, but when I run it with the commands needed and the best options I could find for the compatibility, the game will crash every time I had to load a level outside of the spaceship. Given that this is a community effort in many ways, results can be mixed, and low-end parts are usually not the thing that is tested. ProtonDV is built on top of existing technologies for running Windows apps on Linux, such as Wine and dxvk, a translation layer from DirectX to Vulkan. Now, setting up Wine manually outside of Steam for a specific game can be a tremendously daunting task, which is why there are community-maintained tools like Lutris that do all the configuration for you. Problem is that, like all community tools, results are a bit hit or miss with games that update often, but given enough time and interest from the community, games that are popular enough can do amazing things. Case in point, Overwatch. I touch upon one of my favorite online multiplayer addictions on the old video I did on Linux, and lamented how often, after using all the steps in Lutris, it still was a bit of an annoying, stuttery mess that made it impossible to play. Which might have to do with the shaders compiling, like in Halo, even though I left the game waiting for a long period of time. Also, back when I was recording it, it took 2 days of troubleshooting just to get it to boot. Now on 2020, using my budget Ryzen APU PC, oh, have things changed. Lutris installed it all very simply with no problems, and I knew when to wait for the shaders to compile thanks to a helpful on-screen message. And after that was done, the playing experience was so good, it could easily have fooled me into thinking this was Windows. Overwatch does not have a standardized benchmark tool, but my attempt to use certain scenes as a benchmark led to performance so identical that sometimes it was hard for me to tell if there was a performance impact. This was a huge surprise, since along with Blizzard keeping what appears to be a benevolent stance on Linux players, is an amazing example of what can happen when thousands of hours of work from the community come together and everything just works. If I were to just use this mini PC as a Linux Overwatch box, I could absolutely do it with no issues. And it's a tremendously easier process to set up compared to my last attempt. So going back to my issue with the people constantly suggesting others to switch to Linux, I don't think I can in good faith suggest people switch to a Linux operating system as a performance tactic. I am sure with some pro Linux tweaking, the gap of native games can be closed further, but for a large number of games, being run through a compatibility layer like Proton or just Wine via Lutris, the impact is much smaller than I expected for a low-end system, but still there. But for people like me who care about Linux improving with hopes of having some real alternative in what seems like a dangerously one-horse race, hope continues to exist, especially given the results in something as ideal for an entry-level system as a Ryzen APU. If you own an APU-based PC and fancy playing with an OS that will support it right out of the box, the opportunity is definitely there. But you know what you can also use your Overwatch Linux box to do? Watch content, especially if it is some of your favorite creators flexing their creative muscles. So a problem with how YouTube is structured is that it kinda punishes you for being too creative sometimes. Something that is a bit too different from your usual line? Algorithmically restricted. Something that has to do with war history? Too violent, demonetized. Because of these issues, a large group of YouTubers, including myself, have been working behind the scenes on a streaming platform called Nebula that we control. Nebula is for streaming premium content as well as our usual videos, and there are already a number of interesting original pieces. Some from Wendover Productions, which many of you have pointed out I like, did a documentary on the world's most useful but useless airport and how it is changing the lives of a previously isolated island. If you're looking for something more geeky, there is Working Titles, where each episode is a different creator talking about why the intro to a show is awesome. And I might be working on my own first Nebula original, and it might just be one of the most ambitious pieces of content I have ever aimed to do. If you want to be ready for that, good news, it's going to be super cheap. We're collaborating with CuriosityStream, this video sponsor, on a special offer. CuriosityStream is a streaming service for high-quality, big-budget, non-fiction videos and thousands of documentaries, and one of the best things you could do for your media diet. CuriosityStream is just $2.99 a month, which is absurdly cheap. Now here's the special part. If you use the link in the description, you also get the Nebula subscription for free. You also get a 30-day free trial for both. By signing up to CuriosityStream, you will be helping not just me, but lots of creators as we work together to build a place where we can create new, better content. Thank you to CuriosityStream for everything they are doing for our community and you for watching.